Good morning. Good morning and welcome everyone to our worship on this fine first Sunday in spring. If this is the first time that you've been with us, welcome. If you haven't been here for a while, welcome back. And if you are one of the many people that come and join us every week, we so appreciate you. As we prepare for worship this morning, I would ask that you center yourselves, maybe take a deep breath, close your eyes and let the Holy Spirit pour over you, and welcome that peace and love of Jesus Christ this morning. Please join us in the opening dialogue.
Jesus Christ, light of life, shine in your people here.
Jesus Christ, light of life, shine in your people here.
Stay with us now, put fear to flight, as morning ushers in.
Let us pray the prayer of the day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord of the lost, we are quick to judge and slow to accept those whom we consider lower than ourselves. But you show us the way of acceptance, forgiveness, and peace. We honor your name for teaching us to love, for the sake of the one who is the essence of love itself, Jesus Christ, our loving Lord. Amen. And Now, if you would join in Psalm 141.
Your greatness, O God. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Then he took the 12 aside and said to them, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and insulted and spat upon. After they have flogged him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise again." But they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what he said. As he approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard a crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." Then he shouted, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who were in front of him sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he shouted even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and ordered the man to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has saved you." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, praised God. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, O Christ. So, growing up, it was a joke in my household, and I think my brother Greg started it, but every time we would, after they had started to move away, go to college and things like that, every time we would call home, we would say, "It's your favorite son calling," right? It became an ongoing joke. We would, try and one-up each other. I'm really the favorite son, your most favorite son, whatever it was, because, that's just our natural reaction. Like, we like to be top of the heap. We want to be the favorite. We want to have everybody on our side. And of course it was a joke. Our parents were not picking favorites, thankfully. At least that's what they told my brothers. No, I'm kidding. It's interesting because we see that play out everywhere in a lot of ways, right? Especially with God. We really want to be God's favorites. And you see that throughout history, particularly Christian history, different groups, different crowds, they're saying, we're God's favorite. We've got it right. We've got all the answers. We know the secrets. We're the ones God likes best. In fact, I remember growing up, and it's kind of an aside, but there was a Saturday Night Live sketch of all things, and a man had died, and he was asking his angel all these questions and getting ridiculous answers, and it was hilarious. But at the end, he said, "Who's got it right?" And the angel said, "It was the Lutherans." And I thought, okay, we're good. We got it right. We know it now. But it's just part of our nature. We wanna be right. I mean, that's simply what it comes down to. We wanna know that we've been putting our energy in the right things. But because we wanna know whose side God is on, right? That's a question that I think I know a lot of ministers, a lot of people, a lot of Christians, we wrestle with that idea. Whose side is God on? And maybe we see it particularly in our own nation's history in the Civil War, because both sides claimed righteousness and claimed the same God and claimed that we were on the side of the light of the angels. We see that in some of the songs of the day and certainly in the rhetoric of the day. And you get this in every conflict. God loves us best. We are right. We are righteous. We are the people that God has chosen to be victorious. And if you happen to be the side that wins, well, I guess that proves it, right? Of course, we know that wasn't always the case. So, whose side is God on? Now, of course, God is probably on everybody's side, but is God? This is a question that theologians actually wrestle with. Does God even take sides? And the answer seems to be yes, but not usually in the way that we think about it. Because God does have things that God wants, right? God is not just out there loving everybody all the time. There are things that God wants us to do, calls us to do, encourages us and strengthens us for that work. And there are things that God certainly says, hey, knock it off, right? So we know that God takes sides, but the difference is people. Now, let me explain. We'll look at our text this morning, of course. First, there is God talking to the disciples, who are always the foil for everyone. The disciples who Jesus is telling them he's heading towards Jerusalem, where he's going to die and rise again, and they just don't get it. The text today even tells us that it was kept from them, that understanding. So Jesus is telling them for our sake, not for the sake of the disciples. They still don't get it. And that's an interesting aside. That's an interesting moment where they're not meant to get it. They are clearly on God's side. They're serving and working with Jesus, but they still don't get it. So even if maybe you're on the side of the angels, you might not know everything. So humility continues to be important. But then we get the blind man. Now remember, in the day of Jesus, if you were blind, if you were somehow infirm, this was thought to be a punishment from God for your sins. So this blind man was a sinner. That's how everybody saw him. And even the crowds, they're telling him to keep quiet because he's just a sinner. Stay away from this holy Jesus. You're a bad sinner. But what does Jesus do? He calls him forward and he heals him, disregarding that expectation, that thought that somehow this person was something other. Jesus calls him forward and heals him. And then we have Zacchaeus. Ooh, Zacchaeus was a villain. I mean, that's the thing we don't hear about when we see this story. We see this poor little short guy climbing a tree just to get close to Jesus, but he was a chief tax collector. Now, you have to understand that tax collectors in those days were the worst. They just were. Everybody hated them. In a society where nobody got along, where nobody agreed on anything, the only thing they agreed on was that tax collectors were terrible. Nobody liked them. And I'll tell you why. And I think that if the situation were the same for us, we would not like them too. Because in those days, how Rome collected taxes was they hired locals. They didn't have Roman legionaries go around and take money from people. They hired local people. And Zacchaeus was a chief tax collector. So he had a bunch of his own local people going around collecting the taxes for Rome. So he was already working for a foreign occupying power. And they got rich. All of them were rich. He even says that Zacchaeus was rich. And you know how they got rich? By taking extra taxes, more than they needed. This was just standard practice. So they were the worst. Nobody liked them. Everybody saw that they were corrupt. It would have been difficult for Zacchaeus to have been loved. It's no wonder that he was so desperate to find some in society because he was the heel of everyone. And yet Jesus says, I'm staying with you today, Zacchaeus. I'm staying at your house. I'm going to bless you. I choose you. Even though everybody hates you, I'm coming to your place. And we see that Zacchaeus is changed by that moment of inclusion and love. It's interesting to me because we get this rich man today who is a counterpoint to last week's sermon where Patty was talking about Lazarus and the rich man who was blind to Lazarus, the poor man at his stoop, who ignored him and had received his blessings in life and so was punished in death. He was rich, but his richness was not his sin, nor was it Zacchaeus's. Zacchaeus was blessed because he recognized that he was a part of everyone. He was a part of society. He was a part of God's people. It's not because he was a son of Abraham. It's because he had compassion for those around him. He was willing to see. And it's seeing that is what is the important idea in these texts. It's a theme that we see, and that's what Luke does. He pairs texts. We have the story of the blind man because he was blind, but he saw Jesus where everybody else missed it. And Zacchaeus, the short man who couldn't see over the crowds, but was willing to climb the trees just so he could get a glimpse of who God really was, of how God really worked in the world, of how much God loved him. And it makes you wonder, what are we blind to? The only other thing that brings these people together is Jesus, right? It's the thing that unites all of these people. Lazarus, the poor man at the stoop, the blind man who seeks healing, and even Zacchaeus, the rich trader. God loves them and sees beyond these barriers that the rest of society has already decided they're out. We don't like them. They're sinners. They're no good. We're done with them. God doesn't put up those barriers. God sees beyond those barriers and continues to love them and bring them in. It is remarkable. And the thing that we always miss, I think, as humans, is that they're not a part of any particular group. That's how we categorize ourselves, right? We say we're Lutherans or Methodists or Presbyterians or Muslims or whatever it is. We pick a category and say that group has it right. But it's not about those categories. God never picks that kind of side. God, in fact, clearly states that the Israelites, yes, God loves them, that he chose them to be a light unto the nations, but he can make Israelites sons of Abraham out of the stones. It doesn't make them special. That's not what they're called to be. It's not something that's inherent in who they are, but it's in how they treat other people, how they care about other people. That's the thing that made Zacchaeus righteous. He was generous to those around him when he recognized that what he was doing was wrong. And that's what the rich man missed with Lazarus. A neighbor was in need, and he did nothing. And that's why he was left out in the cold. It wasn't because they were on the right side or on the right team or chose the right banner to follow. Because they treated others just as God treats us, people worthy of compassion and love. That's what the gospel is all about. That's why Jesus was willing to die on the cross. That's why we have Good Friday. Not because we're on the right team or we've chosen the right side, but because we've been given an example of forgiveness and compassion that we are called to extend to all people. That's whose side God is on. If you are a part of an ideology, of a belief, of a Christian church that does not preach compassion to everyone and instead puts people into categories, God is not on your side. Throughout Scripture, we're told that same lesson. Throughout human history, it's a lesson we have to learn time and time again. God doesn't care what category you're in. God only cares if you love those around you. It's not a team, it's not a side, it's not an ethnicity, it's not an ideology, it's love. It's love for others, and that is it. That's all it takes. My job as a minister is simple. It's to share love, to teach love, to encourage love, and to dissuade us from getting caught up in all those ideas, all those ways of seeing the world that divide us. But I never run out of work because we always find new ways to divide ourselves as humans. I never find things that I can't preach about because we are good and creative at saying you're in and you're out. Whose side is God on? God's on everybody's side. Just we have a hard time seeing it. God's on your side. Remember that. And the people you disagree with, you dislike, you hate. God's on all of our sides, encouraging each and every one of us simply to see them as people, not as ideas or enemies or others, but as God's people. Amen. Let's sing our hymn of the day. You are mine. Please join us.
Shadows of the
We invite you now to please join us in our prayers and blessings for the singing of the litany. I have some announcements this morning. The first one being we are coming up on our final Lenten evening service. That's this Wednesday, of course, at 7 p.m. It'll be streaming on the Presbyterian site, though there'll be a link on our Stay Connected page here at Peace Lutheran Church. This is the final one, which means the next week will be Holy Week. In the bulletins this morning, online, or if you receive them, the final page there has a little schedule, because Holy Week, there's a lot of stuff going on. The first thing I want to bring your attention to is to our Easter prayer vigil. We usually, of course, do this every year. It begins at the end of the Maundy-Thursday service and goes all night through till the Good Friday service. We're trying to do a bit of a hybrid thing this year because of COVID, of course. If you are interested in signing up for a slot, you can do half an hour, hours, 4 hours, whatever you want to do. Well, as long as there's room, I should say. But we need you to sign up. We're going to set up some times that we'll have you do it here in the church in person if you're interested, but if you are far afield, cannot travel, or are uncomfortable with that, we're going to do some during a live stream too, so you can do it virtually. Just call the church and set up a time, and we will get that put together. I want to say thank you to Linda Mattis and Gail Eckes, who are putting that together for us this year. I appreciate that work. We're also doing a bit of an experimental service. As things are getting a little better in the world, people are getting vaccinated, we're starting to really talk about what it's going to look like when we open up. So we're doing, an experimental service. We're going to do a sunrise service Easter morning here at Peace in the lawn right here. We're going to do social distancing, wear masks. Unfortunately, the COVID restrictions still, even outside, restrict us from singing together. With that means there's only so many slots. It's hard to say exactly how many because we put together in family groups, but we're working on that, and we're also going to have a sign up for that. So if you were interested in coming, now this means quite early, because sunrise, I believe, is at 6:27, so you got to be there before that. So please join us in the grass, but you got to call and sign up, and of course, all of this is weather permitting. We've got equipment, so if it starts to rain, we can't have the equipment out there, so we won't be able to do the service. So if it's raining at all, It's off, but if the weather's good, if we're blessed in that way, we're gonna experiment with a service and see how it goes so that we can be more prepared when we're fully ready to open up. Also, it'll just be a nice service. There's also, of course, we'll have our regular Easter service live streamed at 10 a.m., so I hope you can join us for that as well. Good Friday and Maundy Thursday will be at 7 p.m. during Holy Week, live streamed as well. All right. I also want to say that the Hermiston Church, a Hermiston Methodist Church, is working on putting together their own sunrise service. They don't quite have all the details out, but stay tuned for that if you are a FUMC people. All right. With that, I believe we can continue with our service, if I can find the page. All right. Let's continue with a great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. I invite you now to pray with us as Christ taught us to pray with our Lord's Prayer. Thank you all for being with us today. We hope that you have a blessed week, and we invite you to sing with us our sending hymn. God be with you till we meet again. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.